Hi all, welcome back. Today we are going to discuss activation and deployment and call management in emergency medical services. The first step in emergency medical services is the activation and their deployment. I am Dr. S. Prakash Babu, in charge of Chodi, Department of Emergency Medicine, PS Medical College, Kuppam. So what constitutes a medical emergency? A medical emergency is an acute injury or illness that poses an immediate risk to person's life or limb or causes a long-term morbidity. The first step in effective and efficient pre-hospital service provision is the activation and deployment. The aim of activation and deployment is to get the right resources to the right patient in the right time frame. It requires efficient call handling and robust call prioritization and intelligent tasking of resources. So activation of emergency medical services follows a defined pattern. You have to use an appropriate telephone number or a local emergency number depending on the country. 108 is the emergency number in India. This is the cycle of emergency medical systems activation and their deployment. An emergency call is made. The call reaches an operator at the call center. The operator determines the service required, whether the person calling requires a medical service, a fire service, or a police service, and then forwards the call to the appropriate service. Once the call is forwarded, the person receiving the call, or also called as in emergency medical systems, is the emergency medical dispatcher. He prioritizes the call, and then he identifies the required resources and amount of resources, and then he tries to mobilize these resources. So what is call prioritization? Most commonly used system for call prioritization is the system of Advanced Medical Priority Dispatch System, also called as AMPDS. What is call prioritization? Call prioritization is when you get a multiple number of calls at the same time, you need to decide which call to attend and which is the most urgent call to be attended immediately. So AMPDS system uses a structured question answer logic tree to allocate a dispatch priority. There are three dispatch categories: red, amber, and green, also called as category A, B, C. Category E is immediately life-threatening situation where you need to immediately deploy without any delay. Amber category is category B, urgent call. You have to deploy based on whether there is an immediate life-threatening injury on the other side or not. Next comes the green category or category C, which is a routine call. You can take your time. If resources are available, you can deploy the EMS. This method is called systematized caller interrogation. AMPDS system lacks specificity and sensitivity, although it is most commonly used and easy system. To overcome this, they have developed a system called HEEMS system, which is more specific and sensitive system. It uses an enhanced caller interrogation system. A dedicated and trained dispatch clerk will take the duties of call prioritization and dispatching. A set of evidence-based criteria which signify severe injury are used to prioritize the call. So what are these evidence-based immediate dispatch criteria? Here, fall from greater than 2 floors or greater than 20 feet height, one under, that is fall or jumped in front of a vehicle, for example a train, ejected from a vehicle, death of the same vehicle occupant, amputation above wrist or ankle, trapped under the vehicle, a request from any other emergency service. So these are the immediate dispatch criteria to be followed. The last step is dispatch. Dispatching is allocating resources to specific location or the site of incident. It follows an integral automatic vehicle location system, wherein once you type the address, the vehicles in that area, nearest vehicles, will be automatically populated and the resources will be shown on the computer screen. So it's easy for the dispatcher to identify which resources he has to allocate to the specific location. The choice of resource will depend on the location, mechanism of injury, number of patients involved, and perceived severity of the injury. Incident details will be either directly sent to the vehicle-mounted data terminals or transmitted via mobile phone. When you are using mobile phone for transmission of the data, the driver of the vehicle has to pull over the vehicle to the side of the road at the earliest moment, and he has to note down the details. Or nowadays, with advanced technology, you can use a WhatsApp messages for delivering the incident details. So this is the emergency call and prioritization tree. An emergency call is taken at the operator's assistant center by an operator, which is related to the emergency control center. The call taker uses AMPDS system, categorizes the call, prioritizes the call into A, B, and C. The call then is forwarded for enhanced interrogation if required, or to a dispatcher if it is an immediate life-threatening situation. When it is forwarded to an enhanced interrogation system, PHEM team comes into action. Specialist resources are deployed. When it is forwarded to dispatcher, he can either request for specialist resources or he can deploy ambulance resource services. So this is the mechanism how the events flow during an EMS call. A responder who is calling the emergency medical services, if he has knowledge of first aid, he should perform life-saving interventions within their limitations. Those who don't know the first aid can remain calm and help responder and the EMS services. There are three stages in call management. These stages define the questions to be asked to the caller and the actions to be performed by the dispatcher. Stage 1 is primary questions, which end in the mobilizing decision. Stage 2 is assessment questions that help build a picture of the incident, aid mobilizing the decisions, and assist the safety of the responders and the caller. Stage 3 is the pre-arrival advice, designed to assist the safety of the caller and the public at the lodge. So what are the aims of using these stages? Why should you use stages? The aims are to ensure that the response is appropriate to the type of risk and calls attended so that you can maximize the benefits. It reduces the risk to the responders and also improves public safety. There are certain objectives for stage 1. You have to identify the nature of the incident and the location. You have to determine potential for loss of life and or property. You have to determine if incident is developing or contained. Aid decision-making process to determine appropriate and proportionate response. You have to determine what action needs to be taken in accordance with the policy for response. The questions that need to be asked during stage 1 include: the patient or the responder identifiers like telephone number, reference number, name, location, address, and unique reference number if available, type, generic, persons involved, incident either developing or contained. Developing incidents means, suppose a fire accident has occurred. It has a start, a progression phase, and an end phase. You have to determine by interrogating the person with in what stage it is, or if it has, the incident has contained. Contained means the incident has started and stopped. For example, an accident, road traffic accident, wherein there is a single incident and then there is no more casualties. You have to check for how to access that location. So these are the questions you need to ask during primary stage. So what are the actions you are going to take? The first and foremost decision you need to take is it appropriate to attend the call? Because your time is precious. So you need to decide whether it is appropriate to attend a call or not. If you are not attending the call, explain to the caller why and offer any advice if appropriate. and you have to decide what resources you are going to mobilize, and then mobilize the resources to the location or to a nearest point. Follow-up actions appropriate to the type of the incident. In stage 2, you need to identify the hazards and risk associated with the incident. You gain critical information for resources attending the incident. Review the assessment in light of further information. Continue to assess the call. Aid the decision as the type of incident, scale and size of response, and provide appropriate safety advice. Actions during stage 1 include: resources need to be adjusted. You might have over-deployed or under-deployed the resources. Depending on development and progression of the incident, you need to readjust your resources. That you are doing during the second stage, where you get more information about the incidents. And whether those resources need to be returned or redirected. There might be some other incident in a nearby place. You might need to redirect those resources to that incident. So you need to decide whether you are ordering the excess resources to be retained or you are redirecting them. That you have to decide. And if you need, extra resources have to be sent to the site of incident. Stage 3 is very simple. You give the caller appropriate pre-arrival safety advice, and action incident appropriate advice is given to the caller or the nearby people for their safety and also the patient's safety. So all these actions, all these decisions will be taken by someone called as emergency medical dispatcher. Who is an emergency medical dispatcher? He is a professional telecommunicator tasked with gathering of information related to medical emergencies, provision of assistance and instructions by voice prior to the arrival of emergency medical services, and the dispatching and support of EMS resources responding to an emergency call. So what are the roles of emergency medical dispatcher? He is the principal link between the public caller requesting emergency medical assistance and the emergency medical services resources delivery system. He has to promptly and accurately process the calls. He has to appropriately dispatch EMS depending on level of care required, give the first responder and immediate actions to be taken, coordinate with online medical directors and the hospital authorities, suggest appropriate hospital to the EMS systems. So take home points for today's lecture include: decide the accuracy and acuity of the call, which is very, very important. Act fast in appropriate manner. You cannot act in an inappropriate manner. You have to act fast, at the same time you have to act appropriately. Tailor the hospital to the needs of the patient. Stabilize the patient en route to the hospital. Thank you.